good evening, everyone. I'm sure that, I hope there'll be some more coming in. We have several already on Facebook Live with us. Now, this week on Facebook Live, I didn't put it on my page first. I put it on Friends of Elm Grove, and that's what I've got on right now. Okay, so maybe that'll work. Thank you, everybody, for joining. Mark Skinner's there. We can see Mark and Linda Gorham from, they live in Iowa or Illinois.
Muscatine, Iowa.
Okay. Becky Ricketts is on there watching.
Hi, Becky.
Good to see you. Well, we've been busy for the last couple of weeks, and it doesn't look like it's going to slow down anytime soon, but I just tell myself, just stay busy, because it says occupy till he comes, so I'm going to occupy, and when he comes, I'll be ready. Amen. And hopefully I'll have a whole bunch of other people ready, too.
I hope this one's in the song, but Feel My Way with Love. I didn't look it up.
Mm-hmm. I got you.
You remember, didn't you?
What?
Oh, where are the songbooks?
I got it.
Okay.
We had moved them back there for all the functions that we were having in here with all of our visitors. We have received numerous.
Sorry. Scared me.
Thank you.
Numerous compliments from all the families and all the folks that have been here over the weekend and all the different functions. We've got just so many folks said that they're just going to make it a regular habit to drive all the way out here to Elm Grove, no matter how far it is, so they can, because they just love our church so much. We appreciate that. Jeff Stanley's joined us now. Kathy Fisher has just joined us.
Yeah, I got you right there.
Thank you, Sister Kathy. She wants a full experience.
247. Glad Sherry's
here. Yes.
Glad Scott's
able to
be here with us
too. Glad to be here.
Felt empty up here without that second guitar. Actually, I'm the second guitar, he's first.
Hey.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Thank you. Page 44. Blessing shines. 44.
44.
Oh,
Praise God, praise God, praise God. Praise you, Lord. Good to see Danny Land has joined us. We're glad to see him tonight. And we're thankful for each and every one of you that join us with live study. Just remind you that if you have a question or a comment, you can just send it in there. And while I won't be able to respond, Sister Nancy's sitting over there with a backup phone, and she'll be able to help get your questions or your comment brought to the forefront. So as we're studying on our continuing study of covenant, now I don't remember exactly how many weeks, but we're multiple weeks into this study.
This will be 32.
This is week number 32 in this study. My, but Brother Sanders is a slow teacher. And we're looking at Isaiah, starting in 54, Isaiah 54. We're going to use Isaiah 55, 56, and 57. And, as far as I got prepared for. But knowing my rate and pace, I don't think that's even, I kind of measured according to what we've been doing for a long time. As we look into Isaiah 54, we're looking into the scriptures where God is reassuring the children of Israel that he is going to be there for them, and that he is going to prosper them, and that he is going to continue to bring about his blessing upon those children of Israel who have once again turned back to God. And as they all turn back to God, this is the promise that he has for every one of them. In our understanding and in our times, we can be assured that these promises that God was making to Isaiah and to the children of Israel for Isaiah are some of those promises that are far-reaching promises. These are promises that come all the way up to us as we stay and stand in the presence of God and in the counsel of the Holy Spirit. Then he's reminding us that all of these great things and all this knowledge about covenant is for him. In Isaiah 54, we're going to use one verse, verse 10. Verse 10 says, "For the mountains shall depart, and the hills be removed, but my kindness shall not depart from thee." I could almost stop and shout right there and just spend a little time just getting a little Pentecostal with it right here. Think about it. My kindness shall not depart from thee. And this is not just somebody making a promise on the spur of the moment. This is God Almighty stating that he is going to be there for you and I. He said, "Neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed, saith the Lord that hath mercy on thee." One of the aspects of covenant, as we walk in covenant with God, is this peace that passes understanding. I've never known a time in all of my ministry, I've never known a time when so many of my people, my church members, the people that I minister, you know, a lot of people call me pastor, and that's okay, that they're not able to attend here, and for lots of different reasons, and the reason doesn't matter. But when I get a little bit discouraged and I get to thinking, well, you know, there's just 50 people here today, and then I get to looking at the numbers of people that go back and watch our services online, and sometimes it just surprises me, but it always delights me to see that many, many people take advantage of these technology things that we're putting out here. Sister Nancy has it on YouTube, we have it on Facebook Live for those that can't make it to be here in person. And the Lord reminds me that opportunity to minister is there. But what I was saying is, I don't know numbers. I can't tell you whether it's dozens or hundreds or thousands. That really doesn't matter. But it seems like so many Christians today don't have peace. There's always something that's robbing them of their peace. And That peace that passes understanding is a promise that God has made to you and me. And I know that if I get to looking at politics, for instance, I have a little trouble keeping my peace close to my bosom. I get to looking at some of the things that's attacking my family and that's going on. We're both of our daughters are facing major surgeries and having health problems prolonged. And I don't know this, but there's always a potential that these things could turn into life-threatening situations. And so, you know, it just, if I get to focusing too much on what's wrong with this one and this one and this one and this one, then my peace is fleeting.
Yes.
And I have to renew myself in my relationship with God. Hello, Brother Stephen. Good to see you joining tonight all the way from Arizona. We love you, brother. We respect you, brother. And I'd just love to have you sit here next to me teaching this series on covenant.
Amen.
Oh, you could add so much. I know you can. And do. Thank you for joining us. God says, neither shall the covenant of my peace be removed. Now that sounds kind of like a steadfast thing. He's not going to remove his covenant of peace. And this peace is for you and I. This peace is found in our salvation. This peace is found in so many of our aspects of life. Many times when I let myself get to lingering on some of these distractions, I get to looking at all the fiery darts that the enemy's hurling our way, and I'm just going to tell you like it is. Sometimes I get worried, and my worry can quickly spin out of control and turn into fear. And I don't know how often I say it, but more than I should, I say, well, what are we going to do if? What are we going to do if? And the answer can be a simple answer, but I'm trying to move into that place where I lean on the Lord, and I don't ask that question so often. Because, you know, sometimes that question will get answers that are not from God, not from the Word. Sometimes it'll be from our emotions. Sometimes it'll be from our surrounding, the people that we surround ourselves with. I was talking with a brother just recently, just had a very brief conversation with him. Don't really even know him. He's just a brother that I met. And he was in a situation where he was soliciting funds for a project. And I told him, I said, brother, I said, I am going to believe that if this project, even though I can't contribute to your project, I just don't have it to contribute, I'm going to believe with you, brother, that we can stand on the scripture and we can take the words of David. You know, David said, hello, Alana. Good to see you. The words from Scripture where David said, I once was young, but now I'm old. But I've yet to see the righteous forsaken or God's seed begging bread.
Yeah.
And I know sometimes we use methods to raise money that, I think we think these things up rather than being led by the Holy Spirit. We can believe and we can walk before God and we can just see great things happen. But when we get all wrapped up in the pressures of economics, when we get all wrapped up in the pressures of economics, we can be quickly robbed of our peace. I've told the story several times. I haven't heard from my brother in quite a long spell. But I have this fella for many, many years. He calls me once or twice a year trying to sell me an insurance policy that'll pay my bills at the nursing home when I go into the nursing home. And I said, brother, has God spoken to you and told you that something's coming my way? And that is this why you're trying to get me prepared for the nursing home? I said, because listen, if God's telling you something about me and he's not telling me, I think maybe you're listening to the wrong God. And but he's always got fresh statistics and he's always got fresh numbers, but I know that his intentions are he is not a bad man. He's not a wicked man, he's not an evil man. He's trying to give me something that I can have that can be a blessing to me, but also something that can be a blessing to him and to his family. Because, you know, every time he sells a policy, he gets a nice little commission. And I believe in commissions for salesmen. I mean, I've made my living a time or two for very short periods of time off of commission, and I know how it is. But I keep telling him that, you know, unless God wants me to be prepared for that particular situation, I said, if God wants me to be prepared for that, I said, I think the Holy Spirit would tell me either one thing, to start putting some money back or to buy your policy. Well, now, the putting your money back in my life has been a no-no. I mean, I've never been able to put money back all my life. I just spend it just as fast as I make it, and most of the time I spend it before I make it. And so I'm always in catch-up mode. But that's all right. God has supplied my needs according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. And it, as long as I'm not out there trying to do something that is in some way contaminating people's lives, and I'm not trying to lure people into something that's questionable, I believe that God's word, I believe God has honored himself and his word to bless me and to strengthen me and to take care of me. I know God's healed me so many times I can't even keep track of all of them. And I can't tell you how many times I've had it. Sometimes a big need and sometimes a little need. But God seems to be taking care of all of my needs and blessing us in so many ways. But why do you think tonight, maybe we'll just have a little bit of a round and around here a little bit, since I've got so few scriptures to cover tonight. Why do you think that so many Christians today are struggling with not having peace? What do you think are some of the sources that will rob us of our peace?
Well, they pay too much attention to the news.
Well, that could be one right there.
Information overload.
Information overload can certainly do it, especially when things are so upside down. They're so upside down. You know, we have all of our brothers and sisters that are in Christ over in the Ukraine right now, and they're facing all kinds of terror and destruction. But one of the things that has happened to them over there is they've lost the ability to communicate in many ways, because the Russians have knocked out the towers that the email or the phones work off of. They've knocked out about the television towers, and so these people are just in dark, and they have to rely on rumors and things going on, and you know that can be a scary place.
Well, and the pandemic, the COVID thing for 2 years now, it's put doubt in some people's minds and hearts and fear.
A lot of people.
So we know that fear is going to rob us of peace. We know that. And I am not one of those people anymore, at least, that thinks that all fear is a terrible thing. I mean, even God teaches us that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And that is a respectful, reverential fear, where we reverence the Lord, and we fear him not in his anger, not in his hatred, but we fear the fact that we might not measure up. We may not bring ourselves fully to the place we need to be. So fear and worry are some things that rob us of our peace. But as Christians, I was reading a little journal entry the other day, and it just really surprised me. One of my organizations that I've joined, you know, when I got old, they want you to join all their organizations. So I was reading one of their articles, and the use of habit-forming drugs is higher amongst those people who are 65 and older, percentage-wise, than it is in the people who are under 65. My generation seems to be more comfortable with using drugs that, not just painkillers, but those drugs that are, I don't even know what to call them, but
Anti-anxiety, tranquilizers.
You know, the drug of choice when Nancy and I were young in the ministry. What was it? Was Valium?
Valium.
Yeah, and we knew a lot of people that were taking that drug on a regular basis.
Valium is very addictive.
And so. The list just goes on and on. Of course, I was just scanning the thing because, you know how they'll put just a little teaser in the front and it'll just get your attention, and you're halfway through the article where you think, well, I don't need this. But that one thought that, okay, now this is about the general public in age 65. So I asked the question, which I could not find an answer to. Well, is it the same amongst people that follow Christ as it is amongst people that don't follow Christ?
I wouldn't think it would be.
Yeah. Like divorce, I think it's going to be about the same.
I think from your point of view in the medical profession, you probably have got a better view on it than I do. And I would guess and say, based on my experience as a pastor in a small church in a rural area, but then having contact with a lot of my pastor friends from this whole area because of some of the committees I work in, I do think that the use of these things is probably about the same as it is in the church family as it is outside the church family. However, I don't want to draw a picture here, and I don't want anybody to get the idea that I'm against any of these things, because I know that God uses a lot of different things to help us, a lot of different surgeries, a lot of different medications, a lot of different therapies, a lot of things like that that God gives us. And I believe that some of these things, I believe all these things are okay until they become a substitute for the working power of God in our life. And even these things, if overused, can rob us of our peace. And so, in Isaiah 55, verse 3, Jesus, or God tells us, incline your ear and come unto me. Hear, and your soul shall live. And I will make an everlasting covenant with you, even the sure mercies of David. What are the sure mercies of David that is being referred to here by Isaiah? What was it about David and mercy that stands out to you?
Well, every time David messed up, he asked forgiveness.
Yes.
He messed up a lot.
I've often wondered why God told us so much of the bad stuff about David.
Because it was real.
It was real.
It makes the good stuff more believable when you show the warts and all.
Yeah, you have. You can't just look at the pretty side of everything or the make-believe side of everything.
It's the fairy tale.
The fairy tale. Yeah. David showed us the good, the bad, and the ugly.
But there's never a trial. There's never a victory.
That's true. But David showed us a pattern. I sinned. I failed God. I go back to God and I seek repentance and conversion and I stop doing that. We don't see David making the same mistake over and over and over and over. Well, some people would say he didn't have to because he made so many other mistakes. But David would go back to the God. And doesn't the Bible say, wasn't it David that it said, God said he was a man after God's own heart? That's the mercies of David we're looking at here. So he says, I'm going to make this living. And he said, all you have to do is hear me. Listen to me. I've been teaching in the adult Sunday school class in the sanctuary, in the fellowship hall here. I've been teaching on the Holy Spirit. And God, in our New Testament covenant, gave us the baptism of the Holy Spirit so that the Holy Ghost, God the Holy Ghost, could teach us so we could hear the perfect, complete, total will of God for our life. There are certain things in the will of God that are same for every one of us. He said, God said, it's not my will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. That's the will of God that's universal for all of us. So if that's the will of God, why don't everybody come to the knowledge of Christ and come to repentance?
Because of our own will.
Because of our will, exactly. And because of the fact that we are not listening as adequately as we need to listen to God. Did anybody in this room ever have trouble hearing from God?
Sure
we do. Some weeks it is travail. And I'm using that word exactly in the context. It's travail for me to hear from God about what I'm going to preach the next sermon. I've got a lot of sermons that are incomplete sermons, that are set aside sermons, ideas for sermons, themes for sermons, even themes for series of sermons. But I don't want to just be a architect or a writer and put together these sermons and just deliver them according to what I think would fit in and what would work. So sometimes the Holy Spirit will remind me of a sermon that I've prepared or started preparing, and I'll go back to it. But that makes my week easy. When it's the most difficult is when I... And do you know when I start praying for next Sunday's sermon?
When you finish Sunday.
Sunday night. Every Sunday night when I'm closing up shop, so to speak, praying and seeking God. I said, Lord, even while I slumber and rest my body, speak into my spirit, my message for next week. Speak into me the message that will touch the most people and touch them the best. And so, but then even though I pray and ask that, I have to listen. I have to incline my ear to hear what God says. Many times, I will be Saturday evening, and I still have nothing on paper. I have nothing on paper. And I started to move into the laptop era and just put everything on my laptop and just, but I found that for me, I needed it down on paper. And but one of the easiest ways for me to put it down on paper, I mean one of the reasons I put it down on paper is on paper I can enlarge the font. And I can separate out the paragraphs and the sentences in a way so that I can kind of preach between if I need to, but I don't get lost. Because if it's all scrunched up together like that, I get lost. So I divide it out seven, and sometimes I'll have 6 or 7 pages of notes and scripture for one sermon. And you'll notice in this particular book, I've got them set up here where I go from page 54 to 55, but then I've got 55 and 56 stapled together, so I just flip the page and I've got everything here right in front of me. And that's another little trick that I do to help. But this last week was one of those weeks when I wasn't sure, and I was listening, I was praying, I was studying every day, getting some little something and working it. But about 4:30 on Sunday morning, it flowed. And there I was in there on my computer, and I was putting it down and getting it into the format that allows me to flow with it. And it was because when I awoke on Sunday morning, I heard the voice of God. Now, I don't know that I heard it as a audible voice like me talking to you right now, but it was audible to my spirit, my human spirit, and it was audible to my mind. It was audible to my soul. I knew that that's what God wanted me to preach. And that was God's message for Elm Grove for last Sunday. Now, here we are, or Wednesday, and I still don't know exactly what I'm going to preach next Sunday. But the scripture here talks to me while we're here studying covenant. I've got some special preparations for my Sunday school that I've been working on, because that's getting really rich and full and deep. And I'm just finding more and more ways to use that as in a teaching format. On the Holy Spirit, God the Holy Spirit. And he says that this covenant, if I'll just hear it, if I'll just listen to it. Can we listen without hearing? Okay. So
we can hear without listening too.
Yeah. We can hear without listening, and we can listen without hearing. Mm-hmm. And you say, well, why are we playing with these words like this, hearing without listening? Well, because sometimes the enemy has learned how to keep so much chatter, so much gray noise,
clutter.
Just so much. When I was getting ready to go and vote the midterm elections and everything, I had been jotting some little notes just to keep myself up to speed on certain things, listening to what this person said about this and what that person said about that. And there was only a couple of people that I was focused on for this midterm election. But
they were primaries,
I'm sorry. I called them the wrong thing. You're right. Thank you, Sister Nancy. By the time I was ready to walk into that, I was completely prepared and knew exactly how I was going to vote in every one of the ones that I was aware of. I'm not so politically inclined that I was aware of even all the different things that the different people that were running. But I just prayed and I asked the Holy Spirit. I said, well, all right, when I get in there and I'm making my marks, for the people that I don't know, you show me the name you want me to, and I'll just follow the leadership of the Holy Spirit. That's what I did. And I was thankful that this time, that every person that I wanted to be the victor in, every person that I prayed about being the victor, every single one of them that I was involved in, and when I say I was involved, I was following them. I wasn't following everybody. But I was completely, completely unprepared for all of the proposed constitutional amendments, and where I was completely unprepared for that. But since I had prayed and listened to the Holy Spirit, as I was there, the Holy Spirit spoke to me about those things, and it was just it was the same flow for those, for the people that I didn't know. And I voted for some people that I didn't know anything about them, but they're the ones the Lord told me to vote for, the Holy Spirit told me to vote for, so I did, and some of those people won. And not all of them, but some of them did. So this message to Isaiah, he's telling the children of Israel, incline your ear, come unto me, come to God, hear, and your soul shall live. Oh, let's take better care of our souls. Let's take better care of our souls. Let's remember that we became a living soul by the very breath of God. And, you know, it's beautiful when we study the Holy Spirit. Did you know that the Holy Spirit is referred to as the breath of God? And even in the Acts 2 and 4 that we spend so much time with, there was the rushing mighty wind prior to. And this could be representative of the breath of God. And our souls don't just need to think about living in eternity, folks. We need to have life in our souls here and now.
Amen.
And so what we have to do, and it's simple to say it now. I know this. It's simple to say it. But we turn our souls over to God when we come to Jesus Christ in repentance and we're saved. We receive so much for our soul there. But let's not forget that the reason we need to go to that altar is because our souls have been contaminated with sin. And we have to get the contaminations out. And who better to show us where they're at and how they work? And, you know, the same things that bother me probably wouldn't bother some of y'all, and vice versa. Mm-hmm. There's probably things that would be a temptation to me, wouldn't be a temptation to you at all. Now, I don't want to go into a lot of dialogue about that, but I think that there's a reality to that. That's why the Lord tells us to work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. So the Lord's will is to for our soul to be uncontaminated. Our soul to be uncontaminated. And circumstances of life, the enemy of our soul, more things than I can list here tonight, try to invade our soul and bring contamination with them.
Even in the first part of that chapter, he's talking about that we waste our money and our time and our talent on things that are temporal, and they're not, I have no, this is my phraseology, yeah, no eternal value. And he said, instead, you need to, you know, set your affection on the things that matter and make that your covenant with me. I just thought that was worth mentioning.
Yeah. Well, let's just look at more of that, Fitz, because Sister Nancy, I had intended to use more of that, and thank you for help. Because in verse 1 of Isaiah 55, he says, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters, and he that hath no money, come ye, buy and eat, yea, come, buy wine and milk without money and without price. Wherefore do ye spend money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which satisfieth not? Hearken diligently unto me, and eat ye that which is good, and let your soul delight itself in fatness. Now, I love that last word of that verse. Delight itself in fatness.
Your soul.
My soul.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. I was getting there. Thank you for helping me. Sister Nancy is a very, very effective communicator.
I'm a helpmate.
She is a helpmate. And the other day she was involved in a little nonverbal communication. We were talking about something that I was overindulging in some of the desserts and stuff that were so lavishly placed around. And she just kept looking at my stomach and then looking me in the eyes. Right at that moment, I couldn't think about that scripture that to delight myself in fatness. Or she would have corrected me and said, "No, that's to your soul. That's not to your body." And she's right. And believe, I'm not criticizing her in any way. I would not be who I am in God, and I certainly wouldn't be who I am as a human being if it wasn't for Sister Nancy and her investment of herself into me and her loving me. I wouldn't begin to think about being a pastor. And see, God prepared us, both of us, to be pastors. And I know that I carry the title of pastor, but she's just as much the pastor of this church as I am. And I want the world to know that. I love her and I'm proud of her. And she does help me be who I need to be.
Randy always says, "I'm the head of the household, but she's the neck."
Sister Nancy has used that same term. Used that same term. I'm the head of the house, but Nancy's the neck that turns the head.
Right.
Well, that's good. That should keep me focused and turned where I need to be focusing. Amen.
And you know, sometimes Kathy will tell me that I wear the pants in the family. She just tells me which ones.
I like that, Kathy. That's good. I like that.
I'm still there.
Then we've already talked on the third verse. It says, "Behold, I have given him for a witness to the people, a leader and a commander to the people. Behold, thou shalt call a nation that thou knowest not, and the nations that knew not thee shall run unto thee because of the Lord thy God, and for the Holy One of Israel, for he hath glorified thee. Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake his way, and the unrighteous man his thoughts, and let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy on him, and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon." Woo-hoo! And hallelujah. Abundantly pardon. Abundantly pardon. Then in Isaiah 56 and 4, it says, "For thus saith the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths, and choose the things that please me, and take hold of my covenant." Now, when the Lord mentions a group of people apart here, as he mentions the eunuchs, we can, if we're not careful, we can say, "Well, that message was just for those kind of people, not for me." But I found out a long time ago that, you know, I was never called to be the king of Israel like David was, but I can take the things that God teaches to David, I can apply them to my life. And maybe that'll help me not make some of the mistakes. What are eunuchs?
Castrated males.
Castrated males.
And set aside for certain,
like royal bodyguards.
Yeah, certain things.
And they were physically altered so that they could perform a very sensitive, a very tender, and a very unique ministry or service. The most common historical use of eunuchs was the rich and wealthy used eunuchs to protect their harems, where those people were in places where they had multiple wives. We know that Saul had multiple wives. We also know that there were eunuchs that were involved in the caring of those wives. We know this from the Bible, and we know this from history. But there's also the idea that we have a spiritual place that, although it's not detailed the same, it's like unto this. We can set ourselves apart in our service for the Lord. And we can set ourselves away from the earthly temptations, the temptations of the flesh. You know that no matter how much we want to try and paint a rosy picture, or maybe when we do this we're just really painting a false front, but Christians struggle with sexual purity just as much as anybody else. And when we think about this battle of trying to be set apart for God, the idea of him using this reference here, and Isaiah using this reference as eunuchs, I think he wants us to see that this is not so much the physical aspect of this chosen persons or persons that do this one service, but it is the spiritual aspect of our souls being set apart for God's service. And therefore, if we set apart our goal, our souls, we should also set apart our bodies. We should keep our bodies pure. We should keep our bodies holy. And I know we teach about this when we teach about adultery, we teach about fornication, but that's not really where I'm leaning in this. The scripture says, deny yourself, deny your flesh, take up your cross, and follow me. And sometimes I believe we don't emphasize as vividly as we should what it means to deny yourself. Some of the reasons that I'm dealing with my nonverbal communication from Sister Nancy about my dessert use is because in certain areas of my life I haven't learned how to deny myself, my flesh. And there's a lesson to learn there. Oh, it might be a light thing. It might be a thing that is even easy to set and joke about. But at the same time, sometimes, why would God teach us in the Word of God about fasting? What is fasting really about?
Denying yourself.
Yeah. And it can be food. It can be habit. It can be entertainment. It can be a lot of things. Fasting a lot of things. And be just as effective spiritually as giving up food. I think the reason that we dwell on food so much is, well, the reason I dwell on food so much is because I'm just a chow hound. I've always been a chow hound. And it's a hard habit to break. It's a hard habit. And I'm talking about overeating, overindulging. I'm not talking about what we all need to eat to live, right? Amen. So let's remember, he said, these are the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths. When he puts that idea in there about the Sabbaths, he's telling us that this is really a message about holiness. It's not really a message about the physical attributes of life. It's about the spiritual. Now, let's just go down two verses. Also, the sons of the stranger that join themselves to the Lord, to serve him, and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it, and taketh hold of my covenant. This is talking about the people that come in, the strangers, that come in and join themselves to the children of Israel in Isaiah's day. But he's saying, look, if they're going to do this, to be his servants, and keep his Sabbath from polluting it, and they take hold of my covenant. Instead of it being their birthright because they're the seed of Abraham, this covenant is something that they can reach for, take a hold of, and they can embrace it, pull it to themselves. Isn't God really saying here that in a way he wants us to draw him to us? To draw him to us? Oh my. Let's just stay just a little bit. Can we just, because I just got one more verse. Isaiah 57 and 8. I will have completed everything I prepared for in one night. The days of miracles are amongst us. Isaiah 57 and 8. Behind the doors also and the post hast thou set up thy remembrance. For thou hast discovered thyself to another than me. And art gone up. Thou hast enlarged thy bed and made thee a covenant with them. Thou lovest their bed where thou sawest it. Here Isaiah is warning the children of Israel that they have to get all of the things that they've snuck in and hidden behind the door. How do you cannot tell what's behind the door until you shut it. Or on the trap, or until you open it. And sometimes something we don't want people to be around or be aware of, we'll take and we'll put it behind it. We'll put it out of sight. I went over to visit a couple one time when we were pastoring in Phoenix, Arizona, and they knew I was coming, but they didn't know what time. I just told them when I got this and this and this done, I'd be to their house. So I come up and I knocked on the door, and she was a little bitty, short Italian gal, and she was very boisterous, very loud, and she came up to the door. She didn't open the door. She just came up and she says, "Is that you, Brother Bill?" "Yeah, it is." "Well, I'm not ready for you yet. Can you wait 10 minutes? And I said, "Sure I can." And I could hear her as she ran away from the door. And sure enough, she had planned on putting some things away before I got there. And it only took her a few minutes, so what a bunch of... And I, to this day, I don't even know where it was. But she said, "Thank you for waiting. You know, you welcomed me in. We had our little visit." And they were new to Pentecost, and they were brand new to our church, and they were a very, very special couple, and learned a lot about Italians, and I learned a lot about people of the Jewish faith, because they were not only Italian, they were Jewish Italian. And so it was a learning time for me. All right, we are through for the day. Thank you so much. God bless everybody online. So good to have each of you there. I hope that the Lord's giving you something beneficial from this.
Yep.